Macroeconomics class. Today we shall discuss the open economy. The reference books for today's lecture are: in this lecture we shall discuss what is open economy, then we shall discuss the savings and investment and the capital flow. After that we shall discuss the effect of policies on capital flow and trade balance, the balance of payment, different kinds of exchange rates, the purchasing power parity, the policy influence on exchange rate, and open economy ISLM model. So let's start with this lecture. Students, as we already know that a closed economy consists of two or three sectors economy. In two sectors economy, the aggregate demand is equal to C plus I and aggregate supply is equal to C plus S. Whereas in three sector economy, the aggregate demand is equal to C plus I plus D and aggregate supply is equal to C plus S plus T, where C is for consumption expenditures, I for investment expenditures, S for savings, G for government expenditures, and T is for taxes. The open economy is also called four sectors economy. In this economy, we interact with external world in terms of exports and imports of goods. So aggregate demand is and aggregate supply is, where NX, that is net exports, represent export minus import. Students, in open economy, for a given year, spending equal to income condition is not binding. That is, a country can spend more than its income or output by borrowing from abroad, or it can spend less, save the additional amount, and lend the difference to foreigners. We know that Y, that is the total output, is equal to domestic consumption, domestic investment, government expenditures, and exports. The X, which represent export, is foreigners' consumption of domestic goods. That is the amount foreigners spend on purchasing and consuming our produced commodities. So, because of X, we can say that consumption is equal to domestic consumption plus foreigners' consumption. Similarly, investment and government expenditures. Therefore, we can rewrite equation 1 as, rearranging it, and we can name it where Y is equal to C plus I plus G plus NX, the conventional form. Students, in this equation, C plus I plus G, that is the total spending by domestic residents, is called absorption. An economy in which output exceeds absorption will send goods abroad, that is its net exports will be greater than zero, and this economy is likely to have a current account surplus. Whereas an economy that absorbs more than it produces will be a net importer, That is, its net exports will be negative and likely to have a current account deficit. Rearranging this equation, we have, and we know that y minus c minus e is the saving, and saving is equal to I plus nx. So saving has two uses. Number one, to increase nation's stock of capital by funding investment, and number two, to increase nation's stock of foreign assets by lending to foreigners. Rearranging this equation, the left-hand side of this identity is the difference between domestic saving and domestic investment, which we call net capital outflow. It is also called as net foreign investment. Whereas the right-hand side is net exports, which is also called trade balance. And this equation shows that net capital outflow is equal to the amount that domestic residents are lending abroad minus the amount that foreigners are lending to us. If the net capital outflow is positive, the economy saving exceeds its investment, and it's lending the excess to foreigners. Whereas if net capital outflow is negative, the economy is experiencing a capital inflow. That is, its investment exceeds savings, and the economy is financing this extra investment by borrowing from abroad. Net capital outflow reflects the international flow of funds to financial capital accumulation. This equation shows that international flow of funds to finance capital accumulation and international flow of goods and services are the two sides of same coin. If saving minus investment or the net exports are positive, we have a trade surplus. In this case, we are net lenders in world financial market, and we are exporting more goods than we are importing. Otherwise, we are net borrowers and we are importing more goods than we are exporting. If domestic savings exceeds domestic investment, the surplus saving is used to make loan to foreigners. Foreigners require these loans because we are providing them with more goods and services than they are providing us. That is, we are running a trade surplus. On the other hand, if investment exceeds saving, the extra investment must be financed by borrowing from abroad. These foreign loans enables us to import more goods and services than we export. That is, we are running a trade deficit. Capital mobility and the world interest rate. As we saw, net export equal to saving minus investment. So, as the trade balance or net export equals the net capital outflow, which equals savings minus investment, our model focuses on savings and investment. We allow the economy to run a trade deficit and borrow from other countries, or to run a trade surplus and lend to other countries. The small open economy with perfect capital mobility. By small, we mean that this economy's share in world market is so small that it cannot influence world interest rate significantly. Therefore, a small open economy can borrow the entire deficit without crowding out its investment. And by perfect capital mobility, we mean that the citizens of the country have full access to world financial markets. That is, they can invest in and borrow from financial markets of other countries without government's restriction. In such case, the domestic rate of interest will be equal to global rate of interest. The world interest rate or global interest rate represented by R star is determined by world saving and world investment. For a simple model, we assume that the output is fixed by the factors of production. The consumption is positively related to disposable income, and investment is a decreasing function of interest rate. So we can write the earlier equation as or this shows that trade balance, that is the net export, depends on those variables that determine saving and investment. We know that saving depends on fiscal policy and investment on world interest rate. Therefore, the trade balance is determined by the difference between saving and investment at world interest rate as shown in this figure. Now we study how different policies affect the trade balance. First, we study expansionary fiscal policy at home. We see the position of the economy before this policy. The gap between investment and saving at global interest rate is net export. Let's suppose that the government pursued with expansionary fiscal policy by increasing government expenditures. An increase in government expenditures will lead to a decrease in savings because of less public savings. This will reduce the net exports as shown in the diagram. A government may pursue expansionary fiscal policy by decreasing tax. In this case, the consumption expenditures will increase and private savings will decrease, resulting in decreasing total savings, which decreases the total net exports as shown in the same diagram. As we saw that because of expansionary fiscal policy, the gap between saving and investment at world interest rate has shrunk. This gap represents net exports, so expansionary fiscal policy results in decreasing the net exports. Now, expansionary fiscal policy at abroad. Dear listeners, if the share of foreign countries in global economy is small, the effect of their fiscal policies is insignificant as that cannot influence the world interest rate. However, if the share of foreign countries in global economy is large, their expansionary fiscal policy reduces world savings, which leads to rise in world interest rate. Increase in global interest rate results in increasing the trade surplus. Next is the increase in investment. An increase in investment demand because of, for example, reduction in corporate taxes or tax credit to producers. Given that saving remains the same, causes the gap between saving and investment to shrink, as shown in the figure. Some of the increased investment may be financed by foreign capital. This results in capital inflow into the economy and makes the net capital outflow negative. In other words, as net exports equal to saving minus investment, so increase in investment decreases net export and thus causes an increase in trade deficit. Students, now the question before us is that is a trade deficit a sign of bad economic state? Students, when a country runs a trade deficit, it is perhaps a symptom of problem. Simply, a trade deficit is not a problem in itself, but it is an indication of a problem in an economy. A trade deficit could be a sign of low saving. We know that in an open economy, low saving results in trade deficit and growing foreign debt, which eventually must be repaid. In other words, low savings and high current consumption lead to lower future consumption, implying that future generations bear the burden of low national saving. However, trade deficits are not always a reflection of bad economic situation. When poor economies develop into modern industrial economies, they usually borrow to finance their high investments. In such cases, trade deficits are a sign of economic development. For example, South Korea ran large trade deficits throughout 1970s and early 1980s, and it became one of the success stories of economic growth. The bottom line is that the economic performance of a country cannot be judged from trade balance alone. Instead, an economist must look at the underlying causes of the international flows. Now, let's discuss the balance of payment. Students, the balance of payment is a statistical record of countries' international transactions over a certain period of time, presented in the form of double entry bookkeeping. A balance of payment provides detailed information about the supply and demand of country's currency. The trade statistics in the current account show the composition of trade, that is, what a country imports and what it is exporting, The capital account, on the other hand, shows the inflow and outflow of capital in various categories. Viewed over the time, the balance of payment data can shed light on important developments in countries' comparative advantage and international competitiveness. Students, a balance of payment account is normally composed of current account, capital account, and official reserve account. The current account records the flow of exports, imports, investment income, and international financial transfers. The trade account records export and import of tangible goods and services, that is, the payments and receipts against the export of and import of physical goods or legal and consulting fees, royalties, and tourist expenditures. Net investment income from abroad includes payments and receipts of interest, dividends, and other income on foreign investment, whereas net unilateral transfers records one-sided payments like foreign aid. The second account is capital account, which records sales to the foreigners of currencies of countries' financial assets and the purchase of foreign financial asset by the resident of a country. The capital account is composed of foreign direct investment, portfolio investment, and other investments. Direct investment involves acquisition of controlling interests in foreign businesses. Portfolio investment represents investment in foreign shares and bonds that do not involve acquisition of control, whereas other investments include bank deposits, currency investments, trade credit, and like other items. The third account is the reserve account or financial account. The reserve account of balance of payment records the changes in the amount of official reserve assets held by the central bank. The official reserve asset include gold, foreign currencies, and reserve positions in IMF. If a country must make net payments to foreigners because of balance of payment deficit, the country could either run down its official reserve assets or it has to borrow a new loan from foreigners. Under a pure flexible exchange rate regime, the central banks do not maintain any official reserves. Any international transaction that creates a payment of money to a country's residents is credit. For example, exports, income from investment made in other countries, remittances, etc. Whereas debts result from payments of money to foreigners. The debit entries are because of imports, purchase of foreign assets, gifts sent to relatives in foreign, etc. If debits exceed credits, then a country is running a deficit. Whereas If credits exceed debits, then country is running a surplus. However, there are some omissions and misreported transactions as well. So we use a plug figure to get things to balance, which is called statistical discrepancy. The balance of payment means the balance on current account, on capital account, and on reserve account. That is, the total sum of three must be zero. Under a pure flexible exchange rate regime, where central bank do not maintain any official reserves, a current account surplus or deficit must be matched by KA deficit or surplus, capital account deficit or capital account surplus. Whereas, under the fixed exchange rate regime, the combined balance on current and capital accounts will be equal in size but opposite in sign to change in official reserves. A current account deficit must be financed by borrowing from foreigner firms, households, or government. Therefore, it increases indebtedness of a country. Whereas a current account surplus implies a reduction in debt or an increase in country's net investment surplus. Therefore, change in international investment position is equal to current account balance plus net revaluations. The national saving is the sum of private and government savings. Recall from magical equation that which is national saving equal to investment plus net exports, and also recall that current account deficit mean net exports less than zero. Therefore, the amount borrowed from foreigners is equal to the negative of net export. This equation shows that foreign borrowing rises because investment increases or because national savings fall. Now we move on to the next topic, which is the exchange rate. Students, the exchange rate between two countries is the price at which the residents of those countries trade with each other. Conventional way is that foreign exchange rate of dollar is usually quoted as the unit of foreign currencies per dollar. However, the euro, US dollar, and pound US dollar exchange rates are quoted as dollar per euro and dollar per pound. These are the exceptions. Nominal exchange rate is the relative price of currencies of two countries. More precisely, the nominal exchange rate is answer to the question, how many units of a foreign currency can I get in exchange for 1 unit of my domestic currency? When people refer the exchange rate between two countries, they usually mean the nominal exchange rate. Therefore, The usually quoted exchange rate is nominal exchange rate. Determination of exchange rate is, the value of currency is determined by demand and supply of currencies in international currency market. This is very much like the determination of price of goods in market. The forces of demand and supply play critical role. The equality of the two determines the value of exchange rate. Now we discuss the changes in exchange rate. The US dollar appreciates if the value of the dollar rises relative to another currency, and it depreciates if its value falls relative to another country. A higher number, that is from rupees 160 per dollar to 168.45 per dollar, means that the dollar experiences an appreciation, or local currency, that is rupees, experienced a depreciation. When the domestic currency appreciates, it buys more of foreign currency, and when it depreciates, it buys less. An appreciation is sometimes called a strengthening of currency, and a depreciation is sometimes called a weakening of currency. Students, keep in mind that appreciation is because of market forces. However, when government intervenes in exchange rate market and artificially strengthens the domestic currency, it is called revaluation. Similarly, instead of depreciation, the term devaluation is called for such situations. The real exchange rate. Nominal exchange rate does not tell you all you need to know about the purchasing power of a currency. That is, although $1 can buy a lot of yen, however, it also takes a lot of yen, thousands or hundreds of thousands, to buy everyday goods in Japan. Therefore, to incorporate the relative prices between two countries in exchange rate, we have a real exchange rate, which is the relative price of goods of two countries. More precisely, the real exchange rate answers the question, how many units of a foreign good can a person get in exchange for 1 unit of a domestic good? The real exchange rate is also called the terms of trade. The real exchange rate is equal to, this formula shows that the rate at which we exchange foreign and domestic goods depends on the prices of the goods in local currencies, and also at the rate at which the two currencies are exchanged. If the real exchange rate is high, the foreign commodities are relatively cheap and domestic goods are relatively expensive. On the other hand, if real exchange rate is low, the foreign commodities are relatively expensive and domestic goods are relatively cheap. The real exchange rate and trade balance. As noted, High real exchange rate means the price of domestic good is high and that of foreign good is low. So, the value of exchange rate determines the import and export of goods. When a currency of a country depreciates, its goods become cheaper to foreigners. Thus, they demand more of its goods, so exports increase. Similarly, the price of imported goods in that country increases. Thus, imports fall. Together, both result in increasing trade surplus or decreasing trade deficit. Relation between nominal exchange rate and real exchange rate can be seen from this formula. We can say that the percentage increase in nominal exchange rate is equal to percentage change in real exchange rate plus percentage change in prices of foreign goods minus percentage change in prices of domestic goods. In other words, percentage change in nominal exchange rate equals percentage change in real exchange rate plus the difference of inflation between foreign and domestic economies. This shows that if the inflation rate differences between two countries, say Pakistan and US, is zero, then the nominal and real exchange rate between Pakistan and US will be the same. However, if from Pakistan's view, the inflation in Pakistan is low than inflation in US, then nominal exchange rate, which is the exchange rate generally quoted, will be higher than real exchange rate. This shows how monetary policy affects exchange rate. As we know, higher money supply leads to higher inflation. So, it also leads to depreciation of currency. The relationship between real exchange rate and net exports can be seen in this diagram. The determination of real exchange rate. Students, the real value of a currency is inversely related to net exports. Net exports, which is equal to net capital outflow, which is equal to saving minus investment. We know that saving is fixed by the consumption function and fiscal policy, whereas investment is fixed by investment function and world interest rate. Since they both do not depend on real exchange rate, so the saving minus investment line represents the net capital outflow, thus the supply of dollars to be exchanged into foreign currency and invested abroad. Whereas the net exports depend negatively on real exchange rate. This downward sloping line represents the net demand for dollars coming from foreigners to buy our goods. At equilibrium real exchange rate, the supply of dollar available from net capital outflow is equal to the demand of dollar by foreigners buying our net exports. This is how the value of real exchange rate is determined. Next is the purchasing. Now, the purchasing power parity. The idea behind purchasing power parity is that similar foreign and domestic goods should have same price in terms of same currency. When all countries produce same commodities and these are freely traded among countries without any restriction, no one would trade domestic goods for foreign goods except on one-for-one basis. Ignoring the transportation cost, the real exchange rate in this case would be equal to 1. So, rearranging it and the nominal exchange rate would be there is some empirical evidence that purchasing power parity holds in very long run, but not in short and medium run. The reasons for this are that countries produce very different basket of goods and services, not the same goods as assumed by PPP. Also that some types of goods and services are not internationally traded. The third reason is that transportation cost and legal barriers to trade may hold the prices of traded goods and services from being equalized in different countries. Now we study the influence of policies on exchange rate. First, we study the expansionary fiscal policy at home. Students, if the government reduces national saving by increasing government expenditures or cutting down taxes, this shifts vertical saving minus investment lines to left, lowering the supply of dollars to be invested abroad. This lower supply causes equilibrium real exchange rate to rise from E1 to E2. That is, dollar becomes more valuable. Because of rise in the value of dollar, domestic goods become more expensive relative to foreign goods. This causes exports to fall and imports to rise. The change in exports and change in imports both act to reduce net exports. Now, the expansionary fiscal policy at abroad. If foreign governments increase government purchases or cut taxes, their policy will reduce world saving and raise world interest rate. The increase in world interest rate reduces domestic investment and thus shifts vertical saving minus investment line to right. This results in rising the supply of dollars to be invested abroad. The equilibrium real exchange rate falls. That is, the dollar becomes less valuable and domestic goods become less expensive relative to foreign goods. So, our exports increase. Next is the shift in investment demand. Now we discuss what happens to real exchange rate if investment demand at home increases. At the given world interest rate, the increase in investment means lower value of saving minus investment. This shifts vertical saving minus investment line to left. Thus, it reduces the supply of domestic currency to be invested abroad. The equilibrium real exchange rate rises, hence domestic goods become more expensive relative to foreign goods and the net exports fall. The diagrammatic presentation is same as it was in case of expansionary fiscal policy at home studied earlier. Next, the effect of trade policies. Students, the trade policies broadly defined are the policies designed to directly influence the amount of goods and services exported or imported. Most often, trade policies take the form of protecting domestic industries from foreign competition either by placing a tax on foreign imports called tariff or by restricting the amount of goods and services that can be imported, which is called as quota. For an example, a protectionist trade policy consider the impacts of prohibiting imports of foreign cars by government. For a given real exchange rate, imports would now be lower, implying that net export would be higher. Thus, the next export schedule would shift outward. In the new equilibrium, the real exchange rate is higher and net exports are unchanged. The equilibrium level of net exports remains the same because the protectionist policy does not alter either saving or investment. This analysis shows that protectionist trade policies do not affect the trade balance. That is quite strange, as one might expect that reducing imports would increase a trade deficit. Reducing imports would decrease a trade deficit. This is because the depreciation of real exchange rate, that is, the increase in the price of domestic goods relative to foreign goods, which led to lower net exports by stimulating imports and depressing exports. Thus, the appreciation offsets the increase in net export that is directly attributable to trade restriction. Protectionist trade policies, however, affect the amount of trade. As we have seen that because of real exchange rate appreciation, exports decline in new equilibrium, but net export remain the same. So the imports decreased as well. Thus, protectionist policies reduce both the quantity of imports and quantities of exports. So the net exports remain the same. Now we discuss the determinants of exchange rate. An increase in domestic output results in fall of exchange rate because higher domestic output pushes up the demand for imported goods and the supply of domestic currency. A rise in output at foreign raises the exchange rate because higher foreign output pushes up the demand for exported goods and the demand for domestic currency. Increase in domestic interest rate raises the exchange rate because it makes domestic assets more attractive and increases demand and decreases the supply of domestic currency. Increase in foreign interest rate results in decreasing the exchange rate. This is because it makes foreign assets more attractive and increases the supply of and decreases the demand for foreign currency. Increase in world demand for domestic good raises the exchange rate. This is because higher demand for domestic goods increases the demand for domestic currency. Now we discuss the exchange rate systems. First is flexible exchange rate system. In this system, the exchange rate between currencies of two countries is determined by market forces of demand and supply, as shown earlier. This exchange rate system is also called floating exchange rate. Under a flexible exchange rate system, exchange rate responds quickly to any economic or political news that might influence the supplies and demands of various currencies. Because of this, there are too much fluctuations in exchange rate, and to minimize this, central banks of many countries intervene in market and minimize the temporary fluctuations. These exchange rates are determined in foreign exchange markets. Principal foreign exchange markets are located in New York, London, Tokyo, and other financial centers. Next is the fixed exchange rate system. Under this system, exchange rates are set at officially determined levels. The examples of fixed exchange rate system include International Gold Standard System, Bretton Woods System, and Market Intervention System. Under International Gold Standard System, the central banks of each country maintain the value of its currency in terms of gold by agreeing to buy or sell gold in exchange for currency at a fixed rate of exchange. The gold standard was suspended during World War I and was temporarily restored in late 1920s. It finally collapsed during 1930s Great Depression. Under the Bretton Woods system, the value of various currencies were fixed in terms of US dollar, and the value of US dollar was set at $35 per ounce of gold. This system was established in 1944 and functioned until early 1970s, when inflation in US made it impossible to maintain the price of gold at $35 per ounce. In market intervention system, many individual countries attempt to fix their exchange rate against a major currency, especially the dollar. Their central banks intervene in market and buy and sell currencies to maintain the demand and supply equilibrium at desired level. By fixing the exchange rates, countries hope to stabilize their own currencies and avoid sharp fluctuations in imports and export prices because of exchange rate fluctuation. For example, from 1991 to 2002, Argentina used a system under which its currency traded one for one with US dollar. The major kinds of exchange rates include spot rate and forward exchange rate. Spot rate is the rate at which foreign currency can be traded immediately for US dollar. For example, if right now the spot exchange rate between rupees and dollar is rupees 165 per dollar, then it means anybody can get 165 rupees against $1 right now. Forward exchange rate, on the other hand, are the prices at which one agrees now to buy foreign currency at a specified date in future. The pattern of forward rate indicates the expectations of participants in foreign exchange market about the exchange rate in future. It is impossible for any nation to simultaneously maintain independent control of domestic monetary policy, fixed exchange rates, and free flow of capitals with other countries. A country must choose the two and sacrifice the third. The European Union's common currency, the euro, and free flow of capital between countries prevent individual European Union countries from pursuing independent monetary policies. Similarly, the US has flexible exchange rate and free flow of capital, so it can run independent monetary policy. This is called trilemma. After getting ourselves familiarized with capital inflows and outflows and with exchange rate systems, now we are ready to explore how exchange rates and international trade interact with the behavior of economy as a whole. To do so, we extend the ISLM model to allow for trade and lending among nations. We use ISLM diagram rather than aggregate demand and aggregate supply diagram because we want to focus on real interest rate, which plays a key role in determining the exchange rate, and the flow of goods and assets. The ISLM curves show different combinations of interest rate and output level, where goods and money market are in equilibrium respectively. That is, the IS curve shows goods market and LM curve shows money market equilibrium. The LM curve is same as it was in closed economy. However, because of net exports, which are now the part of aggregate demand, the IS curve needs modification. However, three main points need to be made about the IS curve in open economy. First, that although the open economy IS curve is derived somewhat differently than closed economy IS curve, it is still downward sloping. Number two, all the factors that shift IS curve in closed economy shift the IS curve in open economy in the very same way. And third, that in an open economy, factors that change net exports also shift IS curve. Specifically, for given values of domestic output and domestic real interest rate, factors that raise a country's net exports shift the open economy IS curve up and to the right. Similarly, the factors that decrease country's net export will shift open economy IS curve down and to the left. Now, first, let's derive the open economy IS curve. We know that in open economy at equilibrium, the domestic saving investment gap is equal to net export. The net export decreases and saving increase with an increase in income or output. And also that net export is negatively related with interest rate, whereas saving minus investment curve is positively related with this. So, in left hand side, we have net export curve, which is downward sloping with respect to interest rate, and saving minus investment curve, which is positively sloped with respect to interest rate. Both of them intersect and gives an equilibrium rate of interest rate, which is R1. We take this interest rate and join it with a specific level of income, say Y1. Now let's assume that income increased to Y2. This increase in output level results in decreasing the net exports, so the net export curve shifts to the left as shown by NX2. The increase in income increases the saving, therefore it shifts the saving minus investment curve to right as shown by saving minus investment curve 2. Both these curves intersect at point E2, and the level of interest rate in the market falls to R2. Joining this level of interest rate with level of income gives us another point. And joining both these points give us the IS curve. As told earlier, all the factors that shift closed economy IS curve to right or left also shift the open economy IS curve to right or left respectively. Higher level of output in foreign economy also shifts IS curve to right as it increases import demand in foreign, which is export for domestic economy. An increase in foreign real interest rate makes foreign assets relatively more attractive to domestic and foreign savers. This increases the supply of domestic currency and reduces the demand for it in currency market. Thus, it causes the exchange rate to depreciate. A lower real exchange rate stimulates net exports and shifts domestic IS curve up and to the right. Now we discuss the policy implications. First, we discuss the expansionary fiscal policy. The expansionary fiscal policy, through increase in government expenditures or decrease in taxes, results in shifting the IS curve to right. As a result, both domestic interest rate and output increase. The rise in domestic price level because of higher aggregate demand results in shifting the LM curve to left. This further decreases the domestic interest rate. Increase in output causes domestic residents to demand more imports and thus to supply more currency to foreign exchange rate market. The increase in domestic output therefore depreciates the exchange rate. However, the rise in domestic real interest rate makes domestic assets more attractive, causing foreign savers to demand the domestic currency and appreciates the exchange rate. The overall effect of increase in government purchases on exchange rate is ambiguous. However, the increase in domestic output and increase in real interest rate both cause net exports to fall. In an interconnected world, the effect of macroeconomic policies in one country are not limited to that country alone. Because the domestic country's imports are foreign country's exports and vice versa, the decline in net export of domestic country is equivalent to an increase in net export of foreign country. If the prices are flexible, as classical economists assume, the price level rise in foreign and output remains the same, but interest rate is higher. If the prices are sticky, as Keynesian economists believe, then the output level remains higher until the prices adjust fully. Now, the contractionary monetary policy. The contractionary monetary policy results in shifting the LM curve to left and up. As a result, the domestic interest rate increases, but output decreases. The exchange rate appreciates in short run for two reasons. Number one, the drop in domestic income reduces domestic demand for imports, leading domestic consumers to demand less of foreign currency to buy imported goods. And the rise in domestic real interest rate makes domestic assets relatively more attractive to foreign and domestic savers. Increasing the domestic and foreign savers' demand for domestic currency, and it reduces the domestic savers' supply for domestic currency to foreign exchange markets. Now, what happens to countries' net exports? Number one, the drop in domestic income created by monetary contraction reduces the domestic demand for foreign goods and thus tends to increase countries' net exports. Number two, the rise in real interest rate, which leads to exchange rate appreciation, tends to reduce net exports. The theory does not indicate for certain which way the net exports will change. Next question is, how does domestic monetary contraction affect economies of countries' trading partners? If domestic countries' net exports are increased by monetary contraction, the foreign countries' net exports must decrease because the domestic countries' exports are foreign countries' imports and vice versa. Output in foreign country declines and foreign real interest rate falls. These results show that domestic monetary contraction leads to a recession abroad. This is all for this lecture. Please post your questions and give your feedback in comments. Also consider visiting other lectures on our channel. We hope you will find them valuable too. Thank you and goodbye.